A 12-year-old girl was being picked on by mean classmates who said they smelled something off of her while she was sitting at her desk. Their activities caused a disturbing situation later on, necessitating the girl's admission to the medical department. In an attempt to shield other preteen girls in similar situations, the girl's mother, Lee Davey, posted the girl's tale on Facebook. After going through a difficult time with her daughter, Lee turned to social media for help. She shared the story of the girl's ongoing bullying at school, which got so bad that the girl tried to end life. In a poignant appeal to other parents on social media, Lee detailed the unrelenting harassment her daughter endured from peers and the absence of any action from school officials. Lee sought public aid as a result of the situation getting worse despite attempts to resolve it privately. In addition to physical bullying, Lee was the target of cyberbullying, for which the parents of the children who were the perpetrators had minimal responsibility because of the intense emotional damage caused by the constant bullying. Lee's daughter, who is currently in a hospital bed, made an attempt to end life. Lee expressed her dissatisfaction with the Department of Education's response and questioned her child's right to a secure education, taking into account the girl's limited access to necessities and the multiple incidents of self-harm at school. The department's proposal to educate resilience against bullies didn't seem very good. Lee talked of a particularly upsetting experience in which her daughter was humiliated and had to go to the ER. The girl's mental anguish and humiliation were exacerbated by a video of her at her desk that went viral on Snapchat with an offensive caption. The cops tried to determine whether it entailed taking pictures and distributing material for 90 minutes. Sadly, our 12-year-old daughter did not fit the requirements for prosecution, but she still had to face weeks of backlash and mockery. The girl who uploaded the video was punished by losing playtime, but the individual who took the video remained anonymous and was spared any sanctions. Angry at the lack of responsibility, I, Lee Davey, posted a picture of my daughter taken in the hospital to highlight the terrible effects of bullying. I've spent 5 hours discussing our daughter's ending life thoughts with psychiatrists, physicians, and nurses just this past week. In this difficult social media age, I implore parents to monitor their kids' messages. Since devices are a privilege, it's important to make sure people utilize them with decency and consideration. Encourage kids to settle conflicts through verbal communication as opposed to texting or using social media. Bullying needs to stop right away because it affects the victim as well as the entire family. I beg others to share my daughter's story online even though it hurts, in the hopes that it may help the fight against bullying in schools advance. Kids should not have to worry about their classmates taking obtrusive pictures or films and then sharing them online with offensive commentary. It is wrong for parents to act in this way, and we must work to improve. It's time for all of us to have discussions about bullying and its terrible impacts with the young people in our lives. That's all about the first story. Now let's watch another similar story. The narrative of Janice Root and Prentice Wilson is a timeless love story that begins with their first encounter at Occidental College in Los Angeles, California. They clicked right away, like in a romance story. And as they navigated the challenges of college life, they fell deeply in love. Tragic events forced the engaged pair to break their engagement, despite the bright future they had ahead of them. After half a century, a shocking discovery forced Janice and Prentice to get back together. But this reunion was very different from their previous encounters. The two were first described as typical young lovebirds, They had met in 1962 at the Occidental College cafeteria. Where Prentice, a freshman, and Janice, a sophomore studying biology, clicked right away. Even though they were fond of one another, their early interactions were characterized by shyness and naivety, which made it impossible for them to look at each other for extended periods of time without blushing. Born and raised in Reno, Nevada, Janice Root carried her father's values, a strong work ethic and a drive for achievement. With her, Janice's father encouraged her to go to college, but he never forced her to. Yet, she was driven to succeed and enrolled at Occidental College to study biology. On the other hand, Prentice Wilson, who came from a wealthier background, was a member of the Kappa Sigma fraternity at Occidental College, where he was pursuing his legal studies and had high aspirations for the future. Wilson's career path appeared to be in line with both his personal goals and the high expectations of his parents. But something unexpected happened when he was serving as Kappa Sigma president. When a black student tries to join a fraternity and causes a stir, it changes Wilson's life at an early age, giving the story an unexpected turn. Prentice Wilson stood up against such overt bigotry after Gene Grigsby's pledge was rejected by the National Fraternity Union on the basis of alone his color. The fraternity as a whole made the decision to break away from the national organization, form their own chapter, and accept Gene Grigsby due to financial difficulties paying for her education. Janice Rood had to work in the cafeteria to make ends meet despite receiving help from her father. Motivated by Janice's commitment to her work, Wilson started rising early in the mornings to be among the first people in queue at the cafeteria. Their quick looks turned into a romantic relationship at first sight, which developed into deep chats and small talk. Wilson remembered their cafeteria encounters with fondness as unquestionably meaningful time spent together. Getting up at 6 a.m. every day to be the first person in Janice's queue. Janice began to worry when Wilson failed to show up because their interactions had grown so precious. Wilson, for his part, acknowledged that his daily schedule was dictated by his need to see Janice and continue their early morning conversations. Wilson had no idea that Janice was looking forward to these encounters. She had purposefully chosen her favorite station, the cereal bar station, where she knew she would definitely run across Wilson. Wilson was a freshman, yet he fit right in at college, did well in his legal studies, led his fraternity as president, and stayed in good physical shape. They continued to communicate every morning for weeks, but they had not exchanged names. Wilson was attracted to Janice, but because of their age gap, he didn't think he had a chance. But he didn't realize Janice was starting to feel the same way about him. Janice Rood looked forward to seeing Prentice Wilson every morning and, if her bravery allowed, exchanging a few words with him. Wilson finally found out her name, Janice Rood, after their first meeting 3.5 weeks earlier. That name will always be ingrained in his mind, and that day came when she saw Prentice Wilson's name in the headlines because of the controversy surrounding his fraternity's decision to split from the national chapter in order to accept a pledge from a black student. Occidental College held a pre-Thanksgiving supper every year as a fun way for students to get together before the holiday. Rood was looking forward to Wilson's appearance in her cafeteria queue and was enthusiastic about the occasion. But that specific day he never showed up. Rood, who was determined to know what had happened, found out that Wilson had gone home early to spend time with his family from one of his friends. Unfazed, Rude made the audacious decision to get Wilson's residential address and contemplated paying him a visit. Janice Rude drove herself crazy for 3 hours to Wilson's home in Santa Maria, playing radio games with herself as she went. When she got to his doorstep, she realized how foolish her choice had been. Shivering at the prospect of traveling so far without even calling him, Rude lingered, dubious about his family's whereabouts. But in the end he knocked on the door. Prentice Wilson, astonished and thrilled to see her, opened the door. Much to her relief, Wilson was overjoyed to have Janice Rude show up at his door unexpectedly. Wilson had been reading on the couch and missed their regular cafe meets. Wilson was delighted by her visit's spontaneity. Much to Rude's delight, her welcome into the Wilson home was kind and her arms were wide open. To make matters better, she received an invitation to Thanksgiving dinner with the family. Everything seemed to be going according to plan. Throughout dinner, Wilson's parents quickly became acquainted with Janice Rude. Echoing his own feelings, Prentice Wilson said that his mother liked her from the first time they met. Rude was relieved that her audacious action had paid off, though they were not quite aware of it at the time. Thanksgiving dinner really signaled a turning point in Rude and Wilson's relationship. Janice Rude returned to university after the dinner, and Prentice Wilson followed her a few days later. This was the turning point at which everything changed. A true bond started to develop between them as their interactions progressed beyond casual talks in the cafeteria. Everyone in their immediate vicinity recognized the couple was a match made in heaven, as they soon became inseparable. Prentice Wilson made the audacious decision to pop the question to Janice Rude because they appeared to be inseparable. The couple, who had only known one another for a few months, found themselves on the road to marriage and couldn't have been happier. At first, they had trouble simply exchanging polite welcomes. They had no idea that their happiness would not last long. As their bond grew and they spent more time together, Janice Rude's father intervened in January, suddenly upsetting them. His daughter's early marriage, especially while she was still finishing her education, was something he disapproved of. As a result, he gave her a harsh ultimatum: break up with Prentice Wilson or else he would stop paying for her college education. Rude was forced to choose between her two greatest passions in life. Her father's sudden intervention gave the matter a fresh dimension. Even though her engagement had previously been announced in the local newspaper, there was an alarming warning at the end of the announcement. No date has been set for the wedding. This was a significant statement for Rude, since she knew she would need her father's financial support to pursue her study. Both Rude and Wilson struggled with the weight of their options when presented with a devastating choice. Rude was adamant about getting a degree since he valued education so highly. She was forced to choose between her love for Wilson and the money she needed to continue her education. Though, tragically, her mother tried to assist by taking out a second mortgage on her home in an attempt to help pay for Rude's tuition and keep the marriage together. These efforts were unsuccessful despite them. Rude regrettably made the decision to quit her relationship with Wilson in favor of giving up on her dreams of becoming an academic. Later, she regretted breaking off the engagement. "My father forced us apart the following January by refusing to pay my tuition if I didn't stop seeing that boy." She never forgot Wilson, even though she continued on to Occidental College to finish her biology degree. Thinking back, Rude conceded that maybe she and Wilson ought to have followed his mother's recommendation to elope at the time. Wilson made the decision to go to college out of concern that she could be drawn to women with greater education. However, following Occidental College, the choice caused them to gradually drift apart. Wilson attended Harvard Law School after graduating from college and went on to become a prosperous tax lawyer in the Bay Area. Rude oversaw her family's successful diving board company in the meantime and was inducted into the USA Diving Association Hall of Fame in Seattle. Wilson and Rude both got married throughout the years, and they hardly ever crossed paths. They thought of themselves as friends even when they didn't. After 47 years, Rude and Wilson both got divorced. Their mothers dying within a few months of each other was a common tragedy. And only then did their minds turn back to one another. A newspaper clipping announcing Rude and Wilson's engagement, a souvenir that both of their mothers treasured, became a common link between them. Moms knew instantly what that clipping meant. And Rude's mother even kept a laminated copy of it in her purse. These newspaper clippings Rude and Wilson found when going through their mom's stuff after she passed away inspired them to get in touch. Wilson and Rude both ended up divorced at the same time in their lives, which was a little of fate. When Wilson eventually got in touch with Rude after a long time, she accepted to meet him at the Cliff House restaurant in San Francisco. They embarked on their first date in decades on June 20, 2010, which begged the issue of whether their spark remained alive. When Rude and Wilson got back together, he could feel the spark was still there. Though they had been away for 47 long years, they resumed their relationship with ease. The pair rekindled their passion 6 months later and became engaged for the second time. There was no doubt that a wedding was going to happen this time, in front of their fellow classmates. Janice Rude and Prentice Wilson were married on August 19, 2012, in a stunning ceremony held on the campus of Occidental College. In an interview with Occidental College magazine, Rude reflected on their voyage and said, "We regret every day that we weren't able to spend time together. Who's counting? Though, when it comes to 17,500 days, after enduring decades of separation, the couple is glad for the chance to finally start a life together and treasures every time they have together."